So it's live. So hello guys, it's Ajay, and today I'm going to organize an event. Here we have our special speaker Vishwas Narayan. So in today's event, we are going to discuss about the computer vision in self-driving cars. So as you know, it's a very fascinating field where they are using LiDAR sensors, cameras, and former pulses, laser beams, and etc. So in this presentation, we are going to cover like how we can utilize this computer vision. There may be a 3D maps or like to spot the objects or for object detection and object localization. For those things, I think Vishwas is going to cover the whole topic in three series. So like first part, we are going to conduct it right now only. And the rest of two events we are going to conduct next further weekends. So over to you, Vishwas. Yeah.
Thank you, Ajay. Thank you so much. Guys, like, let me just get your expectations right. You know, there are ways in which things can go wrong in self-driving car. There are sensor shoots involved. There are algorithms involved. There are ways in which program can interfere. And like I'm saying, in terms of hacking, obfuscation, pruning of neural network architecture, there are a lot of things available. So what I did was, you know, I've been working in self-driving car, the hardware and the software part, you know, basically into hardware because I'm an EC guy, you know, I basically work more towards the hardware part. So what I did was like, okay, fine. Let me just do a complete overview for you guys so that you guys get to know, okay, these are the things that can go wrong in a self-driving car and these are the things that we need to start working. So this is like an introductory series for everything that you are really having your hope upon, whether this self-driving technology is a hope or a hype tomorrow. So I'll be demystifying every part of self-driving car in this thing. And I'll be also sharing you some resources, some Docker Hub, which I've created. My own Docker Hub will be shared to you guys so that you guys don't have to worry about, okay, what can go wrong, what can't go wrong. Like, Docker is very flexible. You can just pull it, run it, and you can start working with it. So, and some GitHub repositories, and also I'll be giving some links on Twitter handles, which I will always be seeing to get the papers, to get the resources, to get the GAN for my everyday life. You know, my everyday life starts with GAN. So I think I've shared my screen. You can share the screen. Add to screen. Yeah, I've shared the screen, bro.
Yes.
Yes, it's there. It's there. It's there. It's coming now.
Visible?
So, yes, it's visible. So, yeah, you know, when you think of self-driving car, oh, my God, where is this? I should have done it full screen, right? Enter full screen. So, I think full screen is available, right? Sure. When you think of driverless cars, it's all based on, like, there should be no driver involved in it. That means no actuation for this entire body of your car should never be done by a self-driving driver or a chauffeur or any person who really is doing it. It has to be completely computed. You know, I'll give you a brief history about this technology. This technology started out with building something called as a radio car. That is what your RC cars today was a dream one day. It was like around 1970s and 1980s when there was nothing called as in communication, which was that sturdy enough, like small antenna, you're having a huge amount of bandwidth or something like that. You know, that's how things are. So let me just give you a brief history of it. My journey started off with my college team called as Brighton Racers, where they were working on solar cars. So what we did was like, we wanted to add in self-driving cars. So we were very close to building a self-driving car, but you know, fundings never happened. So I didn't get disheartened. So now I'm working in Growth Alley EHF as an SD1. So where I'm actually an intern now, but I've been hired as an SD1, where I'll be working on some parts of hardware, which is on blockchain based, which is on self-driving car, which is actually based on hardware optimization and making it more efficient in everyday life. So driverless car dates back in 1930, where it was radio controlled vehicles and everything was like supposed to be handled by a human being, where human decision was supposed to be there for the actuation. So got interesting after 1980s, where people started to work on real vision problem statement, because they saw that, okay, human with two eyeballs with some forces, they are able to give better decisions. The best of the best decisions are made on time. Like today, self-driving cars can't make the best of the best decisions, where I'll be talking about those problem statements in the future, but where I'll be using, like, that's all started off with vans and all of things. They just started off with like sturdy machine, sturdy compute engines. Then cloud computing came in. Then they saw, okay, there is a lot of latency here. Then we have to wait till the 5G. There are a lot. So it started out with 60 miles per hour. Then afterwards, you know, DARPA challenge came in. Then Lyft, Waymo, Voyage. A lot of companies are coming out with their self-driving cars, self-driving car models. So yeah, you know, Ernst Dickerman, all these guys were those pioneers who really worked on Mercedes-Benz based self-driving car. So when you think of Sebastian Thrun, he's a very famous person. If you have seen MIT OCW's robotics lectures, he will be there, that's for sure. And also moreover, he's more into academic field, where he is actually working on problem statements which are like Carla. You know, he's also a part of Udacity. So, you know, he's actually one of those people who actually gives the academic stuff for the Udacity. So that's where Sebastian Thrun comes in. So he has an amazing podcast from Lex Fridman. Lex Fridman is an awesome person when it comes to self-driving car. And, you know, there are a lot of philosophies behind him becoming the lecturer, where he wanted to be a psychologist, understand the working of a brain. But now where he thought, okay, let's build it. So that's where he is heading towards. And we all are heading towards the same thing. That's where I'll come to the end. We'll somehow get involved with the Asilomar principle. Where I'll be giving you a brief intro on, okay, what if we try to build a self-driving car and analyze what's the way in which humans are driving. Human thinking process has never been that demystified as it was today, but it's not enough. Because to give a lot of insights about brain, you know, it takes a lot of years for us to evolve as a human being. It took millions of years to have this sort of an brain. So there are a lot of philosophies in it. You know, I'll be sharing some TED Talks from Susanna Arculano Hollis. I will type it here. I think it would be better. Susanna Arculano Hollis. Arculano Hollis. So I think she's one of the people who have evangelized how the working of the brain really happens. So when you think of her, please, TED Talk. I'll be giving that reference to the TED Talk. It's an amazing TED Talk, by the way. You should just watch it. So yeah, you know, that's where I'll be giving it. So let me just comment it here. Oh, I can't comment. Okay, fine. What is this? Okay. I'll put it in the private chat. You know, you can put it there. So, okay. So where am I? So fine. So I think you guys can watch it. The video is, you know, unavailable. So this is my podcast with somebody called us. Oh, what is this, man? Ajay, can you share me the screen?
Can you share the screen?
I've actually shared the screen.
Okay.
I just stopped the share screen also. Like, you know. Yeah, you know, it's there. You know, when you think of something like self-driving car and technologies like that, you know, there are different companies which are working there. So this is my podcast with a person called as David Silver, and he's an amazing TEDx speaker also. He has a TEDx speaker, and he also was a part of Udacity self-driving car curriculum. So you guys can go and watch it. So this is also one of my podcasts with Akhilesh V, where we actually do a complete overview on self-driving car with respect to data set, with respect to the algorithms. You guys can go and watch it. He works in Flux Auto, which is working on self-driving trucks. You guys can go and watch his podcast. So pioneers in the industry have been much more disruptive these days, because more of engineering has been the approach here, because self-driving cars were involved at every given point of time. So when they involved self-driving cars, there were engineers who worked on the vision only. So Ernst Dickmann is one of them. So this is actually that video where people will can get to know, okay, this is what self-driving car is all about. So that was how a self-driving car was built. So the truck which I was talking, this was the one. So how did Ernst Dickmann do it? So he literally saw that there is a requirement for 4D vision. That means not the 3D that you see on your entire life. You know, it has to be something which is more augmented to the people. So Kalman filter, everything, you know, today when you think of these algorithms, right, you know, it will be like too old fashioned, because these are the algorithms which have evolved over the course of time. When you think of lot and lot of ways in which, you know, self-driving cars have come up, and there are a lot of ways in which advanced algorithms like neural network, GANs have been involved here. But when you think of algorithms like this, these are the one which really work. And fun fact about this algorithm is that, you know, this sensor suite algorithm was so effective in such a way that it was used in a lot of sensors today. Even Kalman filters are used in some of the IoT devices today. So saccadic movement, where neural networks just kept on giving some inference. You know, your neural networks are a go-to results. Like if you don't get an equation to solve that problem statement, just go with an approach called as neural network. So what I was talking about, your 4D vision, the augmented vision, it's all here. It's where you are getting the hue, symmetry, values, and how the triangulation is working. All the things are just nothing but augmentation of the vision. That is somehow a camera needs to make an analysis. So that's where 4D vision comes into the picture. But it's still a 2D image, and we still are working on some more advanced algorithms, some more advanced techniques to evolve over the course of time. So when you are thinking of something called as a stimulus for the presentation, and all these are from the human inferences. That means if humans were machines, what would have been their behavior? So in the speaker note of this slide, I have kept everything about this article. So you guys can go and check it out. So brief history continued. 1990s, everything came up. Universities were funded for self-driving cars and so on. So that's where people really became more efficient in getting the algorithms out, open sourcing their projects, actually making sure that people will get to have some insights about this technology. So the dilemma is in these two books. I've read these two books. These are an amazing hard work, which comes in the form of words. You know, I'm not joking, people. This book gives a complete introduction about what can really go wrong when we are in the self-driving car. It doesn't talk about it, but what if we have connected cars? What if IoT is involved? What if there's cloud involved? What if there is 5G, even though if it's invented, what can be the things which can go wrong? You know, Kevin Mitnick is one of my favorite engineers over the course of time. He's a hacker, ethical hacker, by the way. He was also jailed for a while and a lot of things. But like, he's one in the community who has evangelized the safe hacking. You know, you need not have to hack for the sake of hacking. You can really build a purpose out of it. You can really do bug bounty hunting. I'm not a bug bounty hunter or anything, but like, I encountered some problem statements in my life in which I just had to download an APK for my company, and that company really ruined my money for a while. You know, that's where I started reading all these books, and that's where. So Wired for War is PW Singer's amazing book, highly recommended book. These two books are very highly recommended. Please do read these books because it gives a lot of intuition. So I told you about the DARPA challenge and all these. So Mojave Desert. So Dakar is one of the thing where you measure the endurance of the bike. But there are some competitions which really give out the challenge. And our Driton was actually a solar power car. And we also had an RC car. And we also have a car which is actually working on a petrol engine. So, you know, yeah, you know, we have been working quite a while in our college. So, yeah, that's where I'm proud of my teammates who are there. So Georgia Air Force Base, California, everything came out, and winners of DARPA challenge were there. So multi layers of sensor suites were available. So, you know, when even, you know, I recently did a webinar. Yeah, it's a webinar, not a podcast. Yeah, it's a webinar from Anirudh Kaul, where he actually talks about the self-driving car and the other technologies which are involved there. So yeah, I'll share you that one also. Wait, where you guys can get to know, okay, what is it all about. And also, I also did one webinar with Mr. Amit Mate, sir. You know, he was very good when he was speaking all about that technology. So I was pretty proud of having that webinar on that day. Wait, I'll
we are live now.
Oh, what is this?
I welcome Anirudh Kaul to this wonderful session on.
Yes, I will share it here so you guys can go on and get some gyan about the edge computing and everything like that. Oh, my screen. Where is
do
it?
Do I need to share you?
Yeah, I can hear you. Like, I couldn't see my screen. Like, I could see your screen.
Okay, now you can share.
Yeah, I have shared it. I have shared it. So yeah, you know, this is the one that we are working on over the course of time. So every time when there is, I have shared some links here, so you can put it there. So fine then. So motion planning, trajectory generation, trajectory prediction is actually what we are working. So generation is actually the one which is actually where you are thinking, okay, if this road has a curve like this, what should be my way in which I have to maneuver my entire car over it. So there is a different sensor suite for that also. GPS, a lot of sensor suites involved. On-road navigation, there is GPS, obviously. Zone navigation, obviously, there's a GPS. But there are a lot of things involved. So these are the graphs which you typically see when you are actually working on this kind of technology. So this kind of technologies involve a lot of sensor suites. So DARPA came out with all these approaches. So multi-layered approach. So our aim is to give an intellectual and a sparse-based approach on the self-driving autonomous cars. When you think of sparse, many people have that confusion whether the sparse is actually zeros only. Sparse need not have to be zeros only, but you can infer, quantize your data sets in such a way that it becomes sparse. And you start inferring your data sets on it. You know, sparse is actually memory redundant, where you have very less memory in memory usage, and you need not have to worry about anything. You get that entire architecture in a very small package. So that's where sparse makes picture in your self-driving car. So basic aim is we will be working on the data set and the test cases. So test cases is where I'll be using Eventlet, Streamlet, so on. So I think I've shared the screen. Like, let me just go on and share my entire screen only so that I don't. Oh, yes. So where I'll Streamlet is there. Oh, this is the one where I'll be giving the packages. So, and I have a tutorial which I've designed for everybody. So you guys can go and see that, you know, the Flask tutorial, everything. Actually, you can go and check my GitHub. How my GitHub has everything regarding your self-driving car and lot of things. You know, this is where my self-driving cars and everything. So Docker files are there. So I'll also share you my Docker Hub so that you guys will get to know what's that developer environment that we will be working on. So yeah, you know, that's where I'll be moving on to my slides so that I don't waste my time up. So, oh my God, slides, man. You know, these days slides are so complex to handle. Okay, so we have that. So continued, anything that is D star, where you had an A star algorithm. So where the D star is basically you're making sure that the A star algorithm goes light and you are basically giving a data centric approach. So few better ideologies can evolve over the data set you have. The nature of the data set also matters here, but the way your data set has been processed, pre-processed, and also which is being flown through the neural network, that's where your D star algorithm comes into the picture. So continued errors observed when you are actually giving an approach of self-driving cars. You know, there's a person which is there here. Oh my God, my laser. Yes. So there's a person here and there's a self-driving car here. So a machine doesn't have a feeling. So human level intuition is impossible. So when you think of some crashes, I've also linked and hyperlink here in the speaker's note. You guys can go ahead. Or you can just Google exploring the mechanism of crashes with autonomous vehicle using the statistical modeling approach. This actually gives a lot of insights about the way in which the crashes have happened, the way in which people have really understood what is going wrong to some extent, not to a complete extent, but to some extent, based on the census view data, based on the way in which the inference was done in the real time, so on. So this is one of the example of autopilot where it didn't recognize that there was a doll, which is a dog or something. So it just went on, and you know, just because it had a sensor suite of crash, it just detected after the crash. You know, that's where the autopilot will also say. So, and human level intuition has never been added into a self-driving car, where attention models are the transformers. Google came out with transformers in 2017. That was the time where I joined my engineering, and I'm still exploring about the transformers. So probably if Ajay gives me a chance of part 4 of this webinar, I will do on transformers. Like after learning, if I'm confident of delivering a talk on it. Okay, let me not waste my time here. So the future of many car models are autonomous assisted. Within next 10 years, many manufacturers are expected to have cars featuring steering, braking, and lane guidance. And like when you just go back to my webinar, the podcast from David Silver, he actually says the different level of autonomies and the risks which are involved in that. So you guys can go there. So Google is the one which has adopted the Waymo company. Actually, they have adopted the Waymo company. So in next 10 years, where they are just going to give out a lot of disruptive markets. So yeah, you know, let me just go back and give you some instincts and insights about the Twitter. So Twitter has been one such very, very common thing. So you can go here, just get the papers here, but don't follow it too much, because I don't know whether this is a bot or not, but like it actually is like so irritating, because many, many notifications just keeps on going and off. So I think probably I'll mark some. So Arxiv is one of it. So computer language is that one. So if you are moving more towards the NLP, so hits here. So deep.org is one of the institution where you actually will get to know what's that insight about the research papers. So this gives out ample amount of research papers and so on. So you can follow me for some stupid memes that I always do. And I'm also part of Azure Developers Community Bangalore chapter. So you guys can just join me. I also did a recent webinar on driverless car. So let me just move on with the self-driving car then. So I want to share my other screen, Ajay. I want to share my other screen so that
yes,
yeah, I'm sharing. I've shared my screen, so yeah. So yeah, that was just a brief history of self-driving car, how it evolved over the course of time, and that part should actually give you a brief insights about, okay, if we are working on this kind of a technology, what are the things that we need to keep in mind? What are the mistakes that we are not supposed to be doing? And in my future webinars, I'll be giving you such references also in such a way that you're not supposed to do that mistakes, whether even if you are doing transformer models, how to tune it, how to tune the hyperparameters, how to actually get the real-time simulations through Carla. I'll be working on Carla model also, so don't worry about it. So we basically use Carla just for the testing part. It's not for the production. Production is a different story, and I'm not yet ready for the production level. So when you think of autonomous vehicles, you know, that's where the definition comes in. It's number of well-placed sensors that detect different things such as vehicles, people, traffic, and movement of other vehicles also. This is where technologies come in. So anti-lock braking system, LiDARs is basically the one which I'll be focusing on in the next part of the webinar, where I'll be actually giving you some insights about the data sets where you can collect the LiDAR data sets and you can start working with it. Basically, we'll be working on Kaggle only. Kaggle is where it's huge data sets are being involved and you can really work on it. So Kaggle is one place where I'll also give. Infrared cameras you can really work on. If you are actually looking for collecting data sets, I'm open for a research position where I'll be giving you some insights on, okay, about the data sets, the way you have to collect it, the how you have to collect it, how to annotate it and everything. You guys can reach me out if you have some interest of learning. And I'm also writing a paper there. So if you guys want to really write a review, review paper and a research paper, which is completely within, like, I planned it within the 2 months. So it's me, another guy. And if you come, you guys will be involved here. So we will be working on action prediction, where we'll be taking data sets from the real time and we'll be working on action prediction. So that's where we have come up. So LiDAR system is so expensive. So we plan to use radars or the distance sensor. So this is actually where the things can go wrong, and things are very, very unique over the course of time. So, you know, Tesla doesn't use LiDARs at all, because, you know, he has really said, if you are using a LiDAR sensor, you are doomed, in one of his Tesla talk. You know, that's where 3D, VZ, everything comes into the picture. That is where sparse and other algorithms comes into the picture. So we'll be working on some of the sparse part, and also we'll be working on some spectra image part, so you guys can get to know what we are working throughout. So cruise system is one of the things where you are actually having this cruise control in your car, where you are only going in the same speed for a while. And if you want, you can just control it afterwards. It need not have to be that, you know, you can really go on, just work on some radars and the LiDAR. HB100 radar is there. It's an amazing thing. An open source radar, you can really go on, work with it. And if you are ready for it, there is something called as a ham club in your colleges, I think so. And if not, you can really contact me. I can connect you with some people who wants to join the ham club. Ham club is amazing in terms of getting the things. So ham club is the one place that you need to join for sure. If you want to work on the communication aspects of the self-driving car, you get to get a chance to design antennas, you get a chance to design a lot of other antenna-based systems. So yeah, a lot of things, man. Adaptive speed control, collision avoidance, RP1 sensors, where all these are the sensors used for the control. So types of algorithms are 3D imagers, where 1064 nanometer laser has been involved in your LiDAR. So LiDAR images are the one which we'll be taking. Actually, it's not LiDAR images, it's actually a binary file which we'll be working on in the future. So Google has mentioned, as previously, has made a lot of description, but they have some very good sensors here. Cruise system and Waymo is amazing. Google's Waymo is so good that you actually really want to do it. So this year, Tesla came out with an FSD computer, fully self-driving computer, which is much more efficient than the previous NVIDIA hardware that you're using. The problem with NVIDIA was they have a generalized solution base for all the self-driving cars and everything. So FSD computer came into the picture because they wanted to design it, and they designed it. And there are a lot of people from IBM, NVIDIA, Intel involved, from Tesla, to build such a computer called as FSD computer. You guys can go and come, go and check in the Google. It's called as an FSD computer, the fully self-driving car computer. And there's a research paper on it also, so you can go. So Cadillac with Super Cruise announced on 2014 for 2017 model. So, you know, Super Cruise is one of the autonomous vehicles. So there are ways. So Ford Traffic Jam Assist announced by 2012 itself, but not suitable for Indian road type, because there is lot and lot of human level intelligence which is involved. Machine level intelligence will not work here. So components are lane departure warnings, where, you know, where in US you have to take this turn, this place only, that place only. It's all in the rules. So if you want to have a driving license in India, it probably might take you like 20 days of learning, and probably 9 days of an LL and something like that. But in Dubai, in other places, Dubai is actually much more good in terms of the traffic rules. You know, it takes 72 days to get a driving license. And it's so horrible, because in India, within 72 days, you will be cruising in the roads. But in Dubai, you need to go to the driving school for 72 days. Just need to grind there. Then probably it will end up like 6 months for a driving license there. So yeah, you know, statistics and the professional supports are there. You know, there are a lot of people who are working on here, people who were killed, and the, you know, there are a lot of statistics which he's saying. So there are some professional supports which are coming up, where 72% of people who try to want them in their own vehicle. So people are getting mature more towards the self-driving car and the technology, so you guys can go on and get this. So my podcasts are basically all these things involved, so you guys can go and just get it. So the drawbacks is like Comma AI came out with an average safety which is related to like 2000, you know, within 2000 you can involve comma.ai onto your any car and you can make it much more autonomous today. So comma.ai is also there. So when you have $10,000 for a crude SDS4, as mentioned, you know, there are a lot of things which is there about their cruise system and everything. So poor performance in adverse weather conditions, where if it's more foggy, it won't work proper and so on. So an average is 2000. I mean, probably you can have 10 services by then, but like you have to have that intuition of, okay, comma.ai is giving me such a sturdy thing with jam-packed in one resource or something. Probably it's close to around 3000 or 4000. I don't know about it, but like the prices were like 2000 and starting with it. So there are some adapters which are given to them. So on. So who to blame? The car manufacturers, the programmers, the drivers. We can't blame anybody. So the public acceptance and adoption is basically coming up these days. So there are a lot of ways in which this meme is very, very famous. This meme is very, very famous. So don't worry about it. So these are the people where they have really gone on. So ethical considerations, human drivers may be forgiven for making an instructive or some intuitive mistakes that they have done. But like there are a lot of things. Like, let me just show you one thing. This is an architecture of Netflix. If you guys can see me, like I'll just stop the share screen and I'll just move on. So yes. So if you guys can see my entire screen, right? No, I think this is like reversed version of it. Sorry for it. You can mirror it and see it. This complex is how your architecture is for your entire system involved, which is making decisions in the real time for your Netflix, which is just streaming your videos and all. I have some more architectures where you can also think of this as the Twitter architecture, which is like, this might look simple, but this is very complex. Very complex in terms of just tweeting it, making some decisions. And there are ELK, ETL pipelines, a lot of things involved, man. You know, you can follow me on LinkedIn. This is there in my LinkedIn, so you guys can get to know what's the actual thing, or else I'll share it with, this is the WhatsApp architecture. Yeah, this is the WhatsApp architecture. It's so big and so huge. See, they connect with Vishwas. Yes, so yeah, he connected. He wrote that. Thank you so much. Anyway, I think I can share my screen now. Yes. I have shared my screen. So this is where things are. So when you think of some intuition, I'll be giving you a mechanical introduction of where it is. So trolley problem is where things can go wrong. So if human levels are involved, so you can really get killed. So this is where human level intuition can never be added to a machine. So what if there are four people getting killed? What if there are one people getting killed? You are killing a person, right? So a man can really go rogue and he can really say that, okay, just kill one person. It's better than killing four people. But what if machine makes a decision in such a way that it doesn't recognize all the four people, but it recognizes one people here, one people there? If you are lucky, that one people might go dead, but like, you know, trolley problem is one such thing where mechanical, cognitive, plus the human level intuition plays a major role. So Altrainian analysis is one of the most assumed analogies for the self-driving car architecture. So you guys can really get to know what is this technology all about in over the course of time. So I think I've shared the notebook with him. I think he can share it. But where computer vision is really very tough and really very hard to implement. So in my code, I've commented everything and I'll be giving it in the next session so that you guys can hop in and just can get to learn. So Altrainian analysis is where your algorithms are not working, but the probability of it going wrong is being analyzed. So Altrainian analysis is where you get that real-time and intuitive analysis of an human level interpretation of algorithms. So as told, you know, some memes just for my sake of it, So you can't really just get on and get to know the trolley problem. Trolley problem is one of the most analyzed and most debated topic in the self-driving car. So you guys can get to know that. I'll be using this analysis for the motion planning in the next part of the webinar. That's a very, very short version of the code that I've written, but like it's very intuitive. You need to analyze. I'll be using Lyft SDK. Yeah, I think I need to share you some things about Lyft. Lyft, GitHub, yes. I can't do this, but like I'll just add it here. So I think it's being shared. So I think you guys should actually try this repo from the Lyft and Neural IV is also, oh my God. Oh, fine. I think you guys can hear, oh, sorry for it. I need to make it full screen. So yes, you guys can go there. So neural Lyft nuisance dev kit is actually there. Oh my God, what happened? So this dev kit is very useful when you are doing sparse analysis. So I'll be using this for the sparse analysis part and so on. So I think few slides, I think I'll be moving on with the other things also. So other problems are consequentialism, where consequentially you are basically in analyzing what should be done, what should not be done. So there are a lot of ways, you know, these are very, 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 very discussed problem statements here. So you guys can get to know what's actually there. So these are some of the things which are really available. So new class of victims, like what I showed in that video where the dog was being not predicted from the self-driving car technology from Tesla. So you guys can get to know this. Easing public apprehension is where basically we have to work on getting to override the capabilities of what it's not capable of. Like I'm saying you, it can analyze a vision-based model, but what if it doesn't analyze? So what are your fault tolerance system in the back-to-back? I think there are very very new architectures which are coming up with. I think tether ticketing is one of that entire new architecture. I think can you like make me like in terms of like I think I know that yeah you can you make me in such a way that yeah you know I think this is where there are worker nodes here, there are Kafkas here, there is a Kafka cluster which is involved at every given point of time where worker nodes are making it. So these are some of the fault tolerance system. What if he cancels it and you want to send an SMS or an email of cancellation? So these are some of the fault tolerance systems that you have involved over the course of time. So I think you can share my screen now, I think better so that I can really give some influential. So eventlet is what I'll be working on. So eventlet Python is basically that one framework where you're actually working on what is the actual browser-based deployment. Flask also. Flask will be there. So you guys can go and just check how the things are. So basically, you will be checking on with the data sets and also more of, I think, my Docker. Wait, I'll give you my Docker sets also. Vishwas 9 Docker. So it's here. Let me just pull it up and wait, I'll share my Docker here. Where is my Docker tutorials? Wait, I'll show you that one Swarm based thing where Swarm, Docker Swarm is here. So where, okay, Docker Swarm, where we are actually getting to know the nodes, managing the servers, managing the requests that you're getting in the real time. So this is just like the Kubernetes of your Docker. So you need not have to worry about anything. So this is how things are. So the conclusion is that you have just got a physical level intuition of the thought process that you need to have when you are programming these applications. Because this took me a long time to analyze. I think I've summarized it over the course of time and I've given you this. So yeah, thank you so much guys for this amazing webinar. And also, I think Ajay is one who is running this community in a very good fashion because he is actually very supportive in terms of any people. If you are really worth it, he can really give you a lot of support and support his mother's challenge, Sharda's Kitchen, and his gaming channel also so that he can
thank you so much, Vishwas, for such a nice webinar. Like I think people will get to know how actually what is the scenario of self-driving car in today's for how they are using and the basic technologies. So they will learn many things. Yeah.
You know, thank you so much, Vijay, for giving me such an opportunity for the three-part, maybe four-part, five-part. I don't know about it, but like we'll just go on with it. And like, yeah, you know, it was awesome having you guys in here. So yeah, no, it was very good to have you, man.
Yeah. So
any questions?
Yes.
Yeah, you can.
I just see the comment section, then I'll see.
Can you share? Yeah, I'll share it. Okay, fine. What is bug bounty? Oh, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, I think you can put it there. Bug bounty hunting is one such technique where you are actually going behind the bugs. I'll show you in a very, very, very small fashion. Like, you need not have to go on to any place. I think you guys can see my screen now, right? I think I've shared my screen here. Let me just take something like, what is that? Okay, Google. Okay, let me just do one thing. Let me just go to Lyft. Okay, LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a proper place where you can really go and analyze what is actually happening there. So you can go here. You can click on inspect. And there are console here, you can start really recording. So sources are coming into the picture. What is the thing? So how the data set is moving in and out. And basically you can go to network, you can start recording it. You will get a JSON file. You can stop it, clear it. Then you can have some requests moving on and you will actually hide the data URL and everything about the thing. So you can get to know the elements which are there. Okay, I analyze that image. So what next? So what if the memory allocate based on instruction? So this is how you fiddle with these kind of technologies. So when you start recording, so snapshot has been there. So it's analyzing in the real time. So I'll go to the network. So that transition, whether it is happening in a very proper fashion, like companies want these kinds of insights. So that's where bug bounty hunting comes into the picture, where you are basically analyzing your requirement for your website or anything to run very properly. That's where bug bounty hunting comes into the picture, where companies can't analyze it. So they are just paying you money so that you analyze it. I'm not a bug bounty hunter, so don't grill me on that. But there are bug bounty hunters for self-driving car also. You can ask for that company. I'll hack into your server and I'll get to know what is there. And you can get into a lot of trouble if you do it unethically. You need to have consent. I'm not a hacker, I don't hack anybody, but like I know what's the scenario because I've gone through that, you know, somebody trying to hack me and a lot of things happen.
Okay, Vishwas, thank you very much for the webinar. And I see like there is no more questions left. But still, if anyone is having question, can directly connect with the Vishwas on LinkedIn. I've shared the link on in comment section, so they can directly connect with you. Could you like just give an overview of what you are going to cover in next series?
Next series, I'll be covering a little bit on data sets. There will be no slides there because I know slides is like too horrible. I think I shared one notebook, right? You can contribute to that. You can copy it, contribute to it, send it to me like in the LinkedIn or something so that you guys can get to know what is that thing. I've just commented out everything. I've just kept it in like very good fashion where, you know, you need not have to. Basically, you can go to my LinkedIn feature section where I've kept all my slides and all my code. You can see that where I've done. And also I have a YouTube channel. You can just connect me there and you can just go on. So next part, I'll be doing everything related to the data sets. There'll be no slides, everything related to data sets and the EDA part. EDA part is very important. That is a very short term explanation where I'll be giving about features and everything. So yeah, that will be there. And an insight about the neural network that we'll be working. And the third part is where we'll be working on neural network and the deployment using Eventlit, Streamlit and many other libraries. So yeah.
That's cool part actually. In next sessions we are going to cover the data sets and like after next sessions we are going to implement how like those algorithms are currently working. So That's a very cool thing that we can learn from you, Vishwas.
Yeah, you know, it's my pleasure in working for the community, bro.
Yes. So still we have 15 minutes. So like, would you like to talk on some other topic, or like if anyone is having any question?
Yeah, you know, if anybody has any questions, you can drop it down. Like, this is part one out of part three. Yeah, this is part one out of part three, man. Yeah.
Or it can be extended.
I think I can talk about one intuitive topic that is there in your self-driving car. You guys can go and check out blocks from Onur Mutlu. And basically where Onur Mutlu is actually a person who is working on different techniques, like it's like he's working on self-driving car technology, he's working on bioinformatics, he's basically an hardware guy who is working on every field. I think I can give an intuitive thought about like how is lectures are basically. His lectures are basically more ocean. Sorry for it.
This is
for the containers part. You know, I'll give you a basic intro about it. He is more into architecture of it. So he starts with how the RAM is actually working. You know, how the DRAM refresh works, how the refresh command comes in, and how it really loads the data sets. I think I'll share you the data set. Sorry for the data set. It's link so that you guys can get to know what's the actual hardware that actually goes behind it. He has a lot of channels, but like I feel this is the one which is more very organized in terms of lectures. Every time when you hear his lectures, you'll make a different notes. Like Amit Mate sir, right? I actually have notes for his entire series only. Like this is for the complete neural network thing. Wait, I'll show you that lecture part. Where, yeah. I know this is like flip, but sorry for it. I can't help it. That's how the StreamYard work. You know, when you think of these kind of things which are really working, right? These are the ways in which your row gets architected and the data moves. And there are ways in which your compute cluster in DRAM. This is like the DRAM version and everything. So this is how things are, people. You know, you guys can get to know how far this technology has gone away from your hand. So this is a very good thing. So if you want some notes, I can give you based on bioinformatics also. You guys can come reach me out for the bioinformatics notes. I have some bioinformatics notes also. You guys can reach me out. I also work on some different topics in my hobby time. You guys can reach me out at any given point of time. By the way, I have previously worked on self-driving car. He's currently working on quantum ML and quantum hardware. So I just want your opinion. When do you think quantum architecture will be useful in SDC? Okay, SOCs, there are also. I recently did a podcast with somebody called as Cohen Bertels. You know, he is a very famous person in terms of this hardware and the software thing. He actually gives the accelerated version. He's actually giving a full stack approach for the quantum computing. I would just say quantum architecture has not evolved because we are not trying to demystify something called as brain here. I'll say you how. Brain has evolved over the millions of years. So when you see Susanna Aquilano Hollis's TED Talk, she literally says, after we started cooking, our brain started evolving over the course of time. She is also called as a person who can turn your brain into soup. You know, things are weird. I'll say how. We have not completely demystified the brain and we are trying to do the intelligence. So this is where we are lacking our knowledge for intelligence only. We have not defined how intelligence is also. So that is where our intelligence is not getting evolved over the course of time. The machine intelligence. Human intelligence is evolving over the course of time. And to give an intuitive thought about your quantum computing, you know, there was a talk from IBM Qiskit, which is like, we are too big for this quantum world. Are we too big for, I think there was some title like that. You know, in that he really gives an very brief understanding about how to analyze quantum bits. So when we are thinking of some things like self-driving cars or anything as such, we first need to involve higher level intelligence. Then we can think of quantum, and quantum algorithms are in such a way that it works on something which is more probabilistic. But in self-driving cars, you are working in something called as plausibilistic. You know that somewhere you're car is going to get struck, somewhere the braking might not happen, and somewhere your entire architecture is going to go down somewhere or some or the other point. So quantum needs an involvement, I think, probably until I'm pretty old, that I go 60 years. Now I'm 21. So until I go 60 years or something, probably I don't have any idea about the quantum architecture. But basically, this is how things are in the quantum world. It's so, so freaky that it has no head and no tail. We need to understand a lot about the quantum world before we understand involving it in the self-driving car. So yeah, next questions, I think probably, I think Ajay,
yeah,
DC, self-driving cars. I said in terms of SoCs, system on chips, which are involved in your self-driving car also. Because when you see FSD computer, it's an FSD computer, which is a system on chip. It has RAM, ROM, processing, everything on chip, on one chip. So that's where it's just like the Raspberry Pi for your self-driving car. It's not open source by Tesla. That's it. So I just gave you a hardware level implementation. I don't know about the software because I've never worked with Qiskit, Circ, or anything that you're talking about.
So Vishwas, I'm also having one question for you. So currently, do we have a self-driving car for sale? Like, can we buy those cars?
Yeah, it's not completely like level 5 autonomous ones. I had a client who was actually working on completely a swarm-based intelligence on self-driving car. So these are the ways in which self-driving cars are evolving over the course of time. That means you literally don't have anything which is like self-driving. When you think of level 2 autonomy, you can at least have an efficiency that you are going to break some point of time. Level 3 is even more horrible, where even no system starts working. Like, it makes decisions because of machine which is stashed onto the hood. So when you think of something like that, people are not getting educated about the thoughts. Like, I and you can read a paper from Arxiv. I know most of them know about the Arxiv, but there are some who doesn't know about the Arxiv in this webinar also. So how can you really educate them? So through the webinars, through this thing. But self-driving car is a whole new level of deal. It can't be run by a community. If everybody gets involved, everybody will get to know about the software and they'll start hacking it. So that's where that secrecy is being maintained. And it's only like priced in such a way that it's only $50,000, $60,000. It's not like $10,000, $20,000. Yeah. Like, so there are a lot of technologies which are supposed to be developed. He said about quantum computing. Quantum computing, probably we are not completely demystified, according to me. And many people, even though they are like talking about quantum computing and do this and that, it's still in the theories, but some have gone practical, but not to an extent where we can involve the computation which is required for the intelligence. So I think probably in another 10 years, it's going to be in such a way that even like your Swift is going to have something called as a self-driving car. Because there is something like comma.ai plugins and other companies which might come up and say that you just have to plug in this into your car and everything starts working. So there are things which can go on in the future. I think in future, probably, yes, there can be affordable self-driving cars which will be coming up. But, you know, when you think of like, okay, it needs to just evolve over the course of time, it can't be given to you open-handed. You can mess up with it. I understand the quantum algorithm community is a lot ahead of a hardware community to actually run practical algorithms over hardware. Yeah, that's for sure. I've witnessed some of these, like blockchain. Even in blockchain, they are using SHA-256 algorithms and they're really doing it. But I would just say, you know, until and unless we get to a level where we are going to like -300 Kelvin hardware, which is like go to standard. Like, you can't carry a quantum computer in your pocket, right? It needs a bigger room, bigger than my room, right? I think probably one day it's going to happen, bro. But I don't think like it's going to happen in very recent times, like other 5 years, probably no. I don't think so.
Yeah. Any more questions?
Siddharth, any more questions?
One more. From anyone? Okay. There is no more questions.
I think this is the end of the session. Meet you at part 2 of the webinar, folks. And part 3 is going to be a complete rigorous one. And I think we have planned for a code paper. I think we'll be coming up with that thing also.
Yes, code paper. Yes.
I think me and Ajay will be streaming for 12, 13 hours. So you guys have to be like, we have to have coffee and we have to have the code there. So we'll be coming up with that for sure.
Yeah. Yes, that is going to be amazing, Vishwas.
Yeah, you know, we'll be trying to code and we'll be doing the deployment part to one extent. Yeah, like probably that will be part two, but part one is like we'll be coding everywhere.
Yeah. So thank you very much for attending. And if you still have any questions, you can directly connect with the Vishwas, or in next meeting you can connect with us.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Bye. Okay. Bye.
Bye.